Dear friends, welcome to E-Pathshala. I am Dr. Vishal Jadhav, Department of Sociology, Tilak Maharashtra Vidyapeeth, Pune. Today we are going to look at a module titled Weber's Perspective on Three Dimensions of Power, Class, Status and Party. This is part of the Political Sociology paper. This module will introduce the students to what Weber's understanding was in terms of class, differing from the classical Marxist observation that classes are a product of the means and mode of production, and classes are antagonistic and which are put in binaries as the working class and as the bourgeoisie. Weber differs, and he tries to engage with the question of how power is constructed through these three dimensions. This module will go into them in detail. Marx's model of social stratification as background. Max Weber's work can be read both as a critique of Karl Marx's theories and also as an improvised formulation of certain incomplete ideas. However, his primary objective was to attack the dogmas of orthodox Marxism, which according to Anthony Giddens is like the blind man who insists that he has not lost sight even while blundering into the furniture and unable to make sense of his surroundings. At this stage, it is very important to briefly revise Marxist sociology as a background to Weber's development of alternate theory of power. To put it simply, Karl Marx understood inequalities in society purely through the domain of economy and saw its effect in the formation of class. When we study both the Marxian and Weberian theories of social stratification, it is important to keep in mind the historical context in which they sought to be understood in society. The advent of industrial capitalism of the 19th century Western Europe, the creation of an enormous amount of wealth, but the consequent disparities in sharing it. The workers' protests movements were also a decisive factor in locating both of their works. However, Marx never concretely defined what constitutes a class, and hence the term was rather freely employed. But clearly, he says in the beginning line of the Manifesto of the Communist Party that the history of all hitherto existing society is the history of class struggle. The basic idea in this is all societies are two major social groups, a ruling class and a subject class. The ruling class owns and controls the means of production, that is, they own the land, the factory, the mills, the mines, etc., whereas the subject class provides the labor to make their ends meet. However, the most primitive of human societies were no class societies because there was a very low division of labor and property was owned communally. When the division of labor expands, it generates increased level of wealth, which in turn leads to the growth of private property. According to Marx, this involves the creation of surplus product, which is appropriated by a minority of non-producers, who in turn stand in an exploitative relation vis-a-vis the majority of producers. Thus, the non-producers throughout history dominate the majority producers in each and every epoch. The classes are therefore founded upon a relation of mutual dependence and conflict, hence that of reciprocity. But it is an asymmetrical reciprocity since it rests upon the extraction of surplus value by one class from another. With this notion, power is intrinsically related. Therefore, for Marx, the class which is ruling the material force of society is at the same time its ruling intellectual force, thereby the ruling political force. Therefore, there is an inherent opposition of interest between these two groups of classes that can be called class conflict. Since property relations constitute the primary axis of this dichotomous class system, class can be defined in terms of relationship of grouping of individuals to the means of production, which is in turn connected with the division of labor. In the modern capitalist system, we have thus two classes, a bourgeoisie who owns the means of production and the proletariat who provides the labor and produce stuff but do not own the means of production. However, Marx insists that classes in no way can be identified with source of income in the division of labor, since modes of consumption are primarily determined by relations of production. He emphasizes that such grouping of individuals becomes an important social agency, such as class, only when it assumes a directly political character under a communal consciousness with a focus for communal action. Under such circumstances, a class in itself becomes a class for itself. Weber's theory of power and differences with Marx. The most important thing for Weber was to put social stratification or social inequality in the sphere of power. So, his starting point was obviously different from that of Marx, and the emphasis on power became a legacy of Weber that continued to influence various other scholars in different ways, including the famous French thinker Michel Foucault. In his essay, The Distribution of Power Within the Political Community, Class, Status and Party, about which we have already heard in the first section, Weber provides us with two basic aspects through which he differed from Marx. First, Weber argues there are two other dimensions apart from class by which society is differentiated, status and party. Second, he greatly emphasized on a pluralistic conception of class in some contrast to Marx's dichotomous model. Let us try to understand Weber's theory of power by looking at each of these three dimensions separately. Class and power. To make a distinctive move from Marx, Weber asserts at the outset of his discussion that economically conditioned power is not at all identical with power as such. This, he says, while noting that power may be valued for its own sake, and there is also a complex relationship between power and social honor. While power may lead to social honor, not all power, however, entails social honor. Mere economic power, and especially naked money power, is by no means a basis of social honor. Nor is power the only basis of social honor. We'll come back to the question of social honor and status in the next section. Now let us stay with the economic power. First of all, according to Weber, classes are not communities. They merely represent possible and frequent basis for social action. Therefore, Weber first defines what he calls class situation, and then defines class as a group of people who are found in the same class situation. Now, let us pay close attention to the three factors that he identified as constituents of the class situation. Weber writes, "We may speak of a class when, 1. A number of people have in common a specific causal component of their life chances insofar as this component is represented exclusively by economic interests in the possession of goods and opportunities for income. And lastly, it is represented under conditions of the commodity or labor markets." Let us try to understand what Weber means by this. First of all, a number of people would belong to the same class situation only when the life chances are likely to be affected by a common component. Say, for example, in a politically volatile region, the common component that would affect life chances of the people of that place would be political. A bomb blast, a terrorist attack, or counterinsurgency operations by the armed forces will more or less equally affect the life chances of the people of that region. However, if the common causal component of life chance of a group is a political one, then the group cannot be seen to belong to the same class situation, and hence cannot be called a class. Thus, we come to the second important point. The common causal component has to be an economic one and has to be connected either to the ownership of property or goods, or having or lacking opportunities to obtain specific types of income on the market. Example, lawyers and entertainers. As Weber himself put it, property or lack of property are therefore the basic categories of the class situation. There is a further point to be noted here. Unlike a rigid dichotomous model like Marx's, Weber developed a pluralistic conception of class. He distinguishes between ownership classes and acquisition classes. The distinction is based upon two criteria: A, the kind of property that is usable for returns, and B, the kind of services that can be offered on the market. He further shows how wide-ranging the class situations can be for both the propertied and propertyless. We must remember that Weber defined class strictly according to market interests. which exist independently of whether men are aware of them. Hence, class is thus an objective characteristic influencing the life chances of men, which is distinct from status, as the latter acquires a subjective character. Now we can come to the third point, that of the market. To be part of the same class situation, the common causal component of life chances of a group should not be economic in nature. It also has to be with respect to the market. Now, to give you an example, we can identify Weberian class situation by referring to professional lawyers, doctors, accountants, technicians with different specialities, carpenters, computer programmers, entertainers or professionals in sports. While individuals in each of these may have different backgrounds in conducting their profession and selling their expertise, each has a common relationship to a market. While we discuss about the Weberian idea of class, there is an important point to be made, which distinguishes his approach with that of Marx. This has got to do with the question of class consciousness or class interest. While the Marxian theory assumes the link between class and class consciousness as direct and immediate, to Weber, only under certain conditions do those sharing a common class situation become conscious of and thus act upon the mutual economic interests. Hence, there is a distinction to be made between class in itself and class for itself. It is particularly important to note that Weber particularly attributed the idea of consciousness rather to the status groups which express the relationships involved in consumption. Class, on the other hand, like Marx said, is founded upon the relationships involved in production. The concept of class interest, therefore, according to Weber, is an ambiguous one. However, in the essay we are discussing, he is careful to note that rapid technological and economic changes pushes the class situation into the foreground. And today, the central issues is the determination of the price of labor. Weber argues that the latter may not be a demonstration of class struggle, in that they do not indicate any attempt to change social structures, but are merely disputes over distribution. We must remember that Weber's idea about classes are very different from those of Marx, because the former had a very different understanding of capitalism. Reading other sections of his monumental text, Economy and Society, closely, we can infer that Max Weber took a very keen interest in understanding the origins of capitalism and thereby developed a distinct notion of social stratification. In two fundamental aspects, Weber's theory of modern capitalism differed decisively from the one developed by Marx. One, in his analysis of expropriation, and two, in his treatment of rationality. Therefore, capitalism, according to Weber, is not defined by what Marx would call its contradictory aspect of class conflict. What separates capitalism from the preceding traditional order is the rationalized character of the capitalist mode of production and the associated bureaucratization. This aspect will remain integral even in socialist society, thus foreclosing the possibility of any radical reorganization of social structure after a revolution. The other important departure in Weber's formulation from that of Marx is his clear conceptualization of the middle classes. While to Marx, middle classes were mostly transitional classes, which would eventually sink into the proletariat, Weber greatly rejected his emissarization and pauperization thesis, laying great emphasis on the market position of individuals. Weber went on to classify four categories of social classes: the manual working labor, the petty bourgeoisie, the propertyless white-collar workers, and four, those privileged through property and education. He suggested that the middle class, unlike Marx's proposition, greatly expands with the advance of capitalism. Thus, the immediate future of the working class was rather bound to that of the bourgeoisie, the progress being directly dependent on the bourgeoisie order. Status groups and power. We have already noted that at the outset that for Weber, power is not merely economic. He took up a very different and broad definition of power that included two more dimensions to its distribution apart from the economic one. Accordingly, power in the Weberian model is distributed along three dimensions, and in turn the society stratified into them, namely class, status and party. Weber argued that classes in themselves are not groups, although class situation emerges out of a social action among members of different classes. According to him, groups are more likely to be formed on the basis of status or status honor, then from class situation or class. We can understand the term honor, a sense of distinction, respect or esteem that is generally accorded to an individual by others. We can find expression of social honor in social relationships, in how we interact with each other. What we need to keep in mind is what social esteem may be both positive and negative, which means that the social system, that the social esteem enjoyed by or accorded to an individual may be of a higher level or may also be associated with prejudice, discrimination or separation. Status groups are thus associated with positive, neutral or negative aspects of honor, those favored and those less favored or excluded. In the Weberian model, honor is primarily social in nature, and it would be incorrect to assume that honor automatically results from market or property relationships in economic sphere. To give you an example, outstanding achievement in academics, sports, music and theater draw very high honor in our society, and it will be foolish to suggest that such achievements are solely due to economic class background of the individual. Therefore, we can say that status honor is linked to how society evaluates a group, whereas class is related to the economic or market situation. That is why Weber considers status honor to be more important basis for people forming themselves into groups or communities. In his essay on ethnic groups, for example, Weber notes that different customs may be caused by diverse economic and political conditions of various social groups. But geographic separation or political action can give rise to the belief in blood relationship. In fact, Weber says that both propertied and propertyless can belong to the same status group, and frequently they do so with tangible consequences. Let's discuss three bases of status groups that we can outline through Weber's text. 1. Property. Property is of course a crucial basis for a status group, especially when markets prevail. This is not difficult to understand. It is obvious that those with considerable property or wealth have the means to acquire power in more ways than one. Weber writes, class distinctions are linked in the most varied ways with status distinctions. This is an important point to make, and to which we'll come back again. Weber is careful to note that property as such is not always recognized as status qualification, but in the long run it is, and with extraordinary regularity. To give you an example from Weber himself, we can see how in the subsistence economy of neighborhood associations, it is often simply the richest who is the chieftain. However, that's not the whole story. While property can form an important basis for status, property alone is not key to the status, and status normally stands in sharp opposition to the pretensions of sheer property. Those who acquire property may not be accorded the same status privileges as those who originally held property. One example of this is the distinction between established society and nouveau-riche. Also, according to Weber, status groups may hinder the free development of the market. Alternatively, market privileges may be extended only to those with the proper status level. In India, we can think of how regional, linguistic and caste identities often come into the way of doing business and act as a both enabling and disabling factors. Styles of life. Unlike Marx, Weber, however, was cautious in drawing a simplistic connection between property and power. Therefore, he said, both propertied and propertyless people can belong to the same status group, and frequently they do with a very tangible consequences. That is why we said that during our discussions on the concept of class, that Weberian status groups express relations involved in consumption, whereas Marxian classes express relational involvement in production. While property and income can well be the source of funds required for consumption, it is not so much the source of income that forms the status group. According to Weber, it is rather the set of objects and services consumed which leads to the social honor and associated with social group interaction. Groups may form around residential neighborhoods, professions and educational levels, community associations, professional associations, restrictions based on educational qualifications. Now, If you're wondering how the propertied and the propertyless can belong to the same status group, let us think through an example. The owner of a corporation might earn as much as a practicing cardiac surgeon, although the latter doesn't own a property, in the sense of it being a factor of production, but their property and skills respectively earn them the chances in the marketplace, and hence they can be said to belong to the same status group if other social conditions of honor and self-esteem are met. Group formation without the basis of property. Such groups could be ethnic, religious groups, groups around sexual orientations, and the various urban communities and groups which form around common sets of interests. In each of these cases, there is some amount of positive and negative honor accorded to each group. We can see, therefore, a differential distribution of power. Where religion or ethnicity is an important feature of social organization, belonging to a particular group may involve having identical life chances. We can think about such groups through the institution of caste in India. For an elaborate discussion of how power works through such group formations at the level of status, we can certainly read the work of Dr. B. R. Ambedkar, M.N. Srinivas and Andre Bethe. We can repeat here for what we stated earlier. For Weber, it is not a class group in itself which can arouse consciousness for social action. In other words, such social action is to take place, there have to be popular, proper cultural and intellectual conditions. And that is why the status group is much more instrumental in forging a sense of community than class. But commenting on the social conditions of his time, that is of the late 19th and early 20th century Europe, he notes, today the class situation is by far the predominant factor in the formation of status groups. That he doesn't completely dismiss the possibility that life chances for members of a status group are conditioned economically. Party and power. In the three-dimensional schematic of power that Weber develops, parties constitute the third leg. So according to Weber, parties are another board of distribution of power and of social stratification. Parties can be generally defined as organizations rather than communities or groups, and they often strive for a goal in a planned manner. People form such associations to influence social action. Since they are concerned with achieving some goal, they reside in the sphere of power. That is, classes are in the economic order, status groups in the social order, and parties in the sphere of power. However, we must keep in mind that power is not a separate order, in that classes and status groups are concerned with power too. What Weber means by this is that power is distributed along three dimensions: class, status in the social dimension, and party in the political dimension. Parties are organizations, whereas classes and status groups can be considered groupings of people. It may well happen that if status groups or classes become well organized, they may form parties, or their parties may become organizational wing of the class or status group. Trade unions, professional associations, and ethnic organization and religious institutions are example. So when Weber says that parties reside in the sphere of power, he means that parties are the most visible dimension of social organization involved with power. Class and status groups are also two other modes of distribution of power. Society is stratified along two axes. But the action of the member of a class or a status group is never explicitly oriented towards acquisition of power. On the other hand, parties are visibly related to power. They are formed to create new alignments of power in the society, to acquire power, to maximize the chances of the members of the party to realize their own will in social action, even against the resistance of others who are participating in action. Parties are also different from classes or status groups in that they always involve association, not only social interaction. Weber stressed that parties, political or otherwise, are primarily aimed to influence the existing polity. They may also aim, not necessarily, at the establishment of new territorial domination. But it will be a mistake to assume that parties are products of only modern forms of domination. We should also designate as parties the ancient and the medieval ones, despite the fact that they differ basically from modern parties. And since a party always struggles for political power, we must remember that its organization too is fundamentally strict and authoritarian. To conclude, therefore, we see that Weber had placed much more value in terms of the market determining class status. And this was picked up later by post-structuralists such as Pierre Bourdieu, who also brought in new forms of understanding of power through his understanding of social distinction. Thank you.